Hi, my name is Philip Bither. I'm the curator for performing arts here at the Walker Art Center. And with me this morning is Luis Garay. We just presented the Minnesota debut of his work Maneries last night at the McGuire Theater. And Luis, it's nice to have you here with us.
Thank you.
Could you tell me a little bit about the work we saw last night? You've mentioned in past interviews that it's an archive of gestures, movement, physical elements that you constructed over quite a long research period with Florencia, the main dancer. And she kind of acts like a live DJ pulling from, in the moment, these elements. Could you explain how that works exactly?
Yeah, it was like a practice. There was never like a choreographic process. There is no such thing as choreography, but we understood it like a system and a generative system of movement. So what we generated is a set of rules around the tasks that she has to do.
Right.
So what she has to do is a series of tasks following certain rules and sort of creating her own problems
right. Along
the piece. And so these archives, we created them like for 6-7 months, and then trying to think how, like a DJ, how is this state of the body that she has to reach to organize this, to apply these rules. So we thought it's sort of like a writing machine. And so I think of the viewer as a reading machine too.
The viewers, as
yeah.
What do you mean by machine in that regard?
A writing machine. Like she's
unconscious?
A trace.
Uh-huh, right.
We talk all the time about what the audience is watching. Like she needs to work for your eye. Like I want you to look here, I want you to look here, you know, like right. Like a line that lasts one hour, 10 minutes. I don't know if it's too abstract.
No. And at the same time, follow rules that intentionally upend her, what might be her normal, natural process of movement she would go toward, or other things that set up hurdles for her, almost?
Yeah. Because one of the rules is to contradict herself.
Right.
Not to let every impulse go to its end.
Right.
So if you're thinking to go there, maybe you should go here. You know what I mean?
Right,
like trying
sure.
to generate a state where she knows what she's doing, of course, but at the same time trying to not know what archive she's going to present.
Hmm.
Yeah, so one of the rules is not to do what you thought you were going to do.
Huh.
Yeah.
It's got to be such a interesting, like, psychological challenge for Florencia to both be tuned into the audience, following her own instinct, but at the same time resisting her instincts.
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
So I think it's just interesting what happens when you look for that state. Like it creates inter tension that I think is interesting. Like she has to be inside of herself and going from perception to design, because we work on design. I mean, the way I communicate to the audience that is sitting is her design of this writing.
Right.
But at the same time, she has to place her mind all the time in the audience's mind. So it's sort of paranoid game.
Huh.
Yeah.
Do you find that your role at times working with her, because I know you've now worked together on this piece for 7 years. I mean, you built it and sometimes take it out and tour it, but are you functioning at times almost like a psychologist with her rather than a choreographer?
Yeah, I feel sometimes very, not a psychologist, but like a mental trainer.
Right, yes, right.
Yeah, many times I felt that because, we search all these archives, all these pictures of this symbols and sculptures and iconic postures in history of mankind, and then we try something and we do it sort of a practice, and then we just talk about it, you know. So it gets very mental.
Yeah, even to this day. So after a show, even though you've done the show many times, you'll still get together and say, when you move like this, this is what I felt, or this is how I was thinking, or that kind
of
thing.
Because we try to create sort of, we try to play like we are sort of, I don't know if it's the word, like sorcerers.
Yes,
like we
right.
play to do that on stage.
Right.
So it's to try to create a sort of a state in the audience's body. And to reach that, we work with empathy. Mm. And empathy is something very physical.
Kinetic empathy?
Yeah, so that the audience, you know, it's there in the action. What I want to say is that when that doesn't happen, it's very specific when it happens and when it doesn't happen.
Right.
So she, during this hour of the show, we try to manipulate time. And it's sort of this like very childish thing when I say we try to play like sorcerers.
Yeah.
But sometimes, because otherwise she's just doing forms on stage, and that's not the piece. So she has to create these patterns live and then try to create gaps of time in these patterns. So that's why she tries to avoid these patterns that she's building at the same time. So that sometimes we generate a sort of a hole. That's what I call it, I don't know, a hole in time when you don't know what's happening on stage, or you're so engaged and through your empathy, like a bodily connection to what's happening. And we look for that gap all the time.
Right, right.
So she tries to manipulate time, to create a different time on stage.
Do you feel like that's a universally felt thing, that when you can find that gap, that everyone is feeling it at the same time? Or do people's sense of time relate to each individual within the audience?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. I think I am, like, I work for when it works for me.
Uh-huh.
And I think it's pretty...
shared.
It's pretty shared. Yeah, I mean, sometimes you feel certain kind of silence in the room. That's something that happens, that everyone perceived something that happened. And sometimes it's shared.
Hmm.
Yeah, but it's not, it's shared, yeah, but it, when I see it, it's not like subjective. I mean,
right.
I think it's just very mathematical.
Yeah.
When you create patterns and then you avoid that pattern, you know, it's like repetition and difference. And then something happens.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm not a scientific or a physician or a psychist, but we are trying to look for that we know that has happened in rehearsals or in some performances, and we know what we're looking for. So sometimes it happens, and sometimes it doesn't happen. So we always talk about that.
And you're essentially conjuring. Well, is it too reductive to say you've set these rules and you're shaping the work in order to basically get at a sense of heightened presence in her performance, of like that immediacy and the kind of electricity that she is really in the moment? And
and we always talk about like some sort of like proto presence. Like, sounds very abstract. I haven't talked about this in a long time.
I know.
We are trying to talk about is that what we talked during the rehearsals.
Right.
It was always difficult to talk about because we knew what we were trying to name, because we had seen it both and experienced it and shared it with guests in the practice or something. But we never knew how to put it into words.
Yeah, yeah.
So this reminds me of,
but it's
of
interesting.
Creating process.
I mean, what I find a little unusual is that your reference points, the book you drew from, the other people who have influenced you, seem to be philosophers, theorists, political thinkers, and sometimes that attunement to a formal and theoretical ideas at times will disregard the audience, that it's mostly about form and achieving something that the artist has in mind. But you seem to balance that theoretical adherence to also this attuned interest in the audience itself and what they're experiencing. Do you find that unusual, or is that a generational thing, do you think? Or the reason I ask is that you know, in the postmodern era, and I'm curious if they were an influence on you, if Cunningham was an influence on you in terms of his commitment to a pure dance as its own thing. There was often a sense that we're not doing this for the audience, we're kind of more creating these structures as an experiment and research for ourselves in a certain way.
Yeah, I always think about the audience, but in a very direct way. like I want in these pieces, because then my work changed a lot after this set of pieces,
right,
where we were very obsessed with this iconography and with these archives. After these pieces that were like three or four pieces with this body language and this very systematic interest,
right,
I started to restringe the body and work slower and going almost back to stillness and sculptures. But in this set of pieces, I definitely thought that I was like a formalist.
Right.
You know, talking about Cunningham.
Yeah.
But I always thought, and I always thought about the audience, but in a very direct way, in the sense that in the theater, you sit in a chair and you observe in the front, in this format that I was working at this time. You sit and you watch.
Right.
And that is something very cruel about theater, and I like that. You are
right,
sitting there for 1 hour, for 1 hour and a half, and you're watching. To me, that was like what I want to talk about this.
Hmm.
So I will work for what the audience's eye is watching.
Hmm.
So trying to create some kind of hypnosis.
Hmm.
Yeah, so some kind of like out of the body experience or something like
right,
that. Like
right.
We are all Florencia.
Right.
You know, when the
right.
piece doesn't work, and was she's just amazing because she's an amazing dancer, but it was just a set of forms on stage.
Right.
And people sometimes don't realize it, but we realized, okay, it was not so good because we couldn't, you know, really engage, and just you were there, you know,
right.
the mirror neurons.
Right. Yeah.
You were Florence. It's very clear, it's very basic. You were doing all these forms that are human forms that have, you know, shapes like symbols and iconic.
Yeah. Yeah.
Postures through time. It was your history. You were doing all forms. You were doing that dance.
Right.
Like in the animal children's
yes.
dance.
Yes, Anne Carlson's dance at
yeah,
Children's
those
Theater.
Kids
yeah.
were the animal.
Right.
They were her.
Right.
You know? So we work for that, like to kind of create this sort of hypnosis
yeah.
in a way.
Yeah.
And it's not when you're in a state of hypnosis, I don't think you're. I think it's an interesting question, if it's a hyper-presence or is it a state of non-presence?
Hmm. Right.
Sounds very metaphysical.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, but I think it was interesting for me at that time
yeah.
to think of the theater as an apparatus to research this, the fact that you're watching, ocularity.
Right.
You know, yeah.
Huh. You sometimes use the word ritual, but ritual in a historic sense or a cultural sense, often related to a form of spirituality or creating a kind of an other metaphysical.
Yeah.
But you're sort of more of a formalist dealing with a kind of formal ritual or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I'm very interested in the rituals. And before coming to the States, I was for a month in Mexico trying to research rituals and some local communities and taking mushrooms and peyote and.
Uh-huh. Were these ancient rituals that the people who live there have done for decades or
yeah, Aztecas,
years?
Mayas, like.
Yeah.
And I think it's very, I find it very just human rituals, you know, like it's a moment of like, and it's a like sincereness of something we don't know. I like
right.
that big thought. Like
right.
we don't exactly know what Big Bang was or is.
Right.
And you know, at the end of the, I like those thoughts a lot, like this sense of some sort of cosmicness.
Yeah.
I like to think about that. And I like going to observatories, and I like the idea of the space and the infinity. And it's very like, yeah, like it's there all the time. And I
right.
like to think a lot about that, because you just feel so small.
Right, yes.
Like humankind history is just so short. And I feel that rituals, you know, it's this moment of offering, of emptiness, because rituals are some sort of empty actions that you feel with intentions
mm-hmm.
that can, you know, that can be actions or given through language
right.
and repetition. But I think rituals try to fill a gap of something that we don't know.
Do you think rituals are more important than ever in modern times, in the 21st century, or do you feel like they've lost their meaning?
No, we've lost it
yeah.
completely,
right.
of course. Like
yeah.
when you I mean, one of the most amazing things that I experienced when taking these mushrooms and these cactuses is the sense of appreciation to, like, water. You know, it's so simple, and it so sounds so hippie and
new age.
Yeah. But it's true. Like, I was in Mexico, and you just imagine these Mayas and these Aztecas, like, going through the jungle and watching these leopards in the trees on mushrooms.
Right.
And then the water is just like liquid diamond, and you are like, this is water. And they knew that, and they built these pyramids on mushrooms, and all their offerings were to the fire.
Right.
Because fire exists, to the water, because they couldn't believe that water existed.
Huh.
And that is so basic.
Right.
And I like that, and of course we have lost it. Like, we have no idea that our iPhones come from minerals that are in, you know, India and Africa.
Yes, right.
We have no idea.
Right.
And they had a lot of idea.
Huh.
And I think that's very contemporary. Like, many of the theories and many of the themes that contemporary art has been interested in the last couple of years, like in this horizontalization between humans and objects, losing some kind of self-anthropocentrism, this human, you know, vision that contemporary art is so interested on working on that and creating metaphors and poetic actions to look at the world in a different way, so that we are not so, you know, like, humankind, so central, so important.
Yes,
like, all these indigenous had it so clear. Mm. Like, their stones were their grandmas, and the water was, like, you know, their friend, and fire was, like, you know, a god.
Right.
They were very modern.
Have you thought yet what you might do with those experiences and this current strain of thinking around utilizing it for a new next performance, or
In the installation that you sort of saw, the building up
in
France,
right?
It was sort of a playground.
Yeah,
people is inside the stage, and a lot of like raw materials that were there, like wood and mud, mixed with like actions with technology. And, but this sense of playground is very nice.
Hmm.
I think it's very ritualistic.
Yeah.
And I think that this piece that we're presenting here, Maneries, and the ones that I did around it that time, they have to do with that, because, you know, it's very risky, it's very fragile, and it's very simple in the way that I want you to appreciate a piece of skin or a body breathing.
Right.
Or, you know?
Yeah.
And it's very subtle. And sometimes it happens.
Right.
Sometimes it doesn't happen.
Yeah, yeah.
But I look for that. And I think that's very, like, you know, look at the water.
Yeah.
It's water. Like,
is the fragility of the work central to its power?
I think so. And I think that's why the piece has been touring like for 6 or 7 years, because we have refused to just set it. And sometimes it goes bad.
Right.
And some people may not realize that.
Yeah.
And we are still trying to look for that engagement.
And does
that we talked about. Yeah.
It seems like it puts you and Florencia and Mauro and others, like, you are always under a pressure to deliver. And it requires a certain kind of risk willingness, not just on all your part, but on your presenters and your audiences.
Yeah.
And everybody's in it together, sort of like, will it work? Will it work? And,
It's very fragile.
Yeah. The piece feels very universal in a certain way, but would you say your upbringing in Colombia or your adult life in Argentina informed this piece at all? Or would you say it could have been made had you lived anywhere?
Yeah. Well, it's an interesting question, because I'm still thinking about that. Like, you know, I was born in Colombia, and I don't, I'm like the, like, I'm a generation that doesn't really believe in frontiers, and, you know, I was born in sort of the early internet generation, not totally inside the internet, like the kids that are being born now, but early internet, and, you know, like, like modernity, and just traveling is easier than when my parents lived, and, you know, I take planes, and I, you know, that's modern. That didn't used to happen.
Right.
But then I think and I believe it is not the same to be American than to be Latin American.
Right.
It's not the same to be European or to be Asian.
Right.
I'm not Asian.
Right.
You know, I'm not European. And I don't care anything about Colombian customs or food, or I don't miss anything about Colombia or Argentina. And I don't consider myself Argentinian or Colombian. Like, I don't really care. Never think about that.
Yeah.
But I'm definitely not French.
Right.
You know, so I think a lot about that.
Have you been thinking about it being in this first kind of major tour of the U.S. of like, you're not American, North American either.
I just I think a lot about the fascination of the States. Like, it's very fascinating and it's very scary at the same time. Like, or maybe that's what I've been looking at, because I've been trying to look at that.
I think we overstated how many people were carrying guns last night on the street.
Yeah, but it's fascinating in the sense that I am aware that I am like in the nest of capitalism and, you know, Western culture, and I'm West.
Right.
You know, I like Buddha and I like meditation and rituals and, you know, but I'm West, and it's all about, like, you know, your goals and your mind, and, you know, as much as we try to challenge those ideas, it's like about me being in the center of the world.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
And I work to fight that, but I'm West.
Right.
And it's just you know, I see it very clearly here in the streets. You know, you can do it if you want.
Like
service, comfort.
Right.
You work for it. You pay for it. You deserve good service.
Right.
You know what
I
mean?
Yeah.
It's an idea of working hard, and I like that too.
Right.
It's this idea of that you work and you get what you deserve because you worked.
There's supposed to be direct rewards for your hard
work.
Yeah,
and it's very competitive.
Right.
Because it's you, you know, going in the world.
Yeah.
And it's not the same as in Latin America. Hmm. You know? You feel it everywhere, in the coffee, in a restaurant, in the streets, you know. I don't know.
Here in the States.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, well, going back to dance.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think this idea of rituals, well, there were also Native Americans here, and I'm sure they had a lot of rituals, and in Europe too. But maybe, I don't know, maybe in Latin America it's more recent.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know. My grandparents lived in the mountains, and they didn't have electricity. And but I don't know. Maybe here is the same.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Quite the same. Yeah. I mean, there was a destruction of the Native people. That was pretty was severe.
In Argentina, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Like the Spanish, you know, there is a very famous war in the north of Argentina called, what is it called? I don't remember, I will remember.
Yeah.
And there's extermination
of
indigenous.
Here, same.
Like a total extermination.
Back on Maneries for a second, although this is a train that I would, I was curious of the, at one point, Florencia disrobes and performs without any clothing on. Was that a key important to see the body fully in that way? I was curious about your choice to either have her partially clothed at the first two thirds and then change and then come back. Was that a way of stripping away so the human form is even more present? But then you brought her back again into. Kind of athletic wear.
Yeah, it's those kind of decisions you take on the process and sort of like some kind of unconscious dramaturgy. Mm. I mean, the piece has reached to a point of intensity. There is a scream.
Right. She's screaming to the back of the wall.
Yeah, tonight we're going to do it to the front because the ice stage is so deep.
Yeah, right.
That it should be more sound.
Right. Yeah, yeah, right.
We're going to try that.
Okay.
I just felt like, and after that moment, there will come some references of like classical beauty, Venus.
I noticed that I thought there were samples, so, like you were referencing pieces of, masterpieces of of visual, of painting and things.
Yeah.
And,
So it just felt, I don't want to say the word natural because what's natural, but it felt coherent.
Yeah.
You know, we are like almost in the middle of the piece. We have reached an intensity, and we're gonna work first with some Venuses, and then with a more tribal body that it's all in the floor. So it felt proper and coherent.
Yeah.
To have no clothes.
Yeah, and the athletic musculature of her body. There's at moments times where it seems blurry. Is she a man or a woman? I mean, were you intentionally playing a little bit with the gender binaries around?
With the lights, yes.
Yeah.
We didn't think about that during the process.
Right.
Because it's the way she is. She's an interesting performer.
Yeah.
Ambiguous. But then with the lights, we realized it was more in haste. You know, sometimes if you have the shadows, it will be more animal or masculine, and then maybe more feminine.
Yeah.
So we discovered that when doing the lighting.
And could you talk a little bit about the sound? The sound is mixed live too, although clearly it's built on a structure that has kind of a arc.
Yeah, we try to apply the same rules to the musician, DJ. He comes from a very nightclub background.
Yeah.
And although the structure is very firm and is the same, we try so that he could also have sets of sounds that he could apply live.
Yeah.
So we try to do that. At the beginning, he used to play more, but as the time passed, we sort of cleaned the sounds, so now there is much less sounds.
That he's
so
doing,
see that he doesn't have so many archives of sounds to play with now,
right,
as he did some years ago.
There was much more diversity of sound.
Yeah, but I thought that was taking attention away.
Ah,
like,
right.
It was too decorative, so we were cleaning.
Yeah. Could you ever have imagined this work on another dancer? Could you keep the same rules, structure, the building process, and have someone else do the work as well? Or
I mean, the thing
did
is
you
that
kind
we,
of make it,
was,
it together. In a
the
certain
thing
way.
Is that it was. Like so intimate process,
right?
That you know, it would feel so stupid to call someone else,
right?
It would feel like I haven't even thought about that.
Like, yeah,
I just say we can't, or
right,
I'm ill, or she's ill,
right?
I didn't, you know.
Yeah,
I haven't been so ambitious, like to say, okay, let's pass all this process.
Right.
Someone else. Although we have talked about these archives and all these rules and all this process with other performers in other group pieces that we have shared all this research.
I wondered about that, yeah.
Yeah. But I wouldn't be like, okay, let's, you know.
Right.
We have some performances in Australia, let's get someone else.
Yeah. I think I was meaning more like, not for this piece, but like, can you transfer that process other works?
Yeah, there is.
Yeah,
I danced with her in another piece, but then at the end I went off and another performer went in. And it's her dealing with all these rules and also a guy,
right.
Another very nice performer from Buenos Aires.
Yeah.
So we have shared this, yes. Mm. And actually once we did an open rehearsal in Buenos Aires of this piece, and there were some presenters very surprised and very, like, sort of happy. Like, it's so nice to see this material and this research on other bodies.
Oh.
Like, they were like, oh, you know, of course it's about her. But they were like, oh, so this research has gone also been, you know, beyond her.
When you talk about archives, you know, the Walker Art Center here is a multidisciplinary place that has a collection of visual art, a very dense archive of material, physical materials, drawn from a history of contemporary art and performance. Do you think of your archive in a similar concrete way? I mean, for instance, have you notated or recorded all of the thousands of gestures and materials that are there for Florencia to draw on?
Well, other inspiration is this, Werburg, I don't know the pronunciation very well, archive.
Uh-huh.
So he was this crazy guy. He attempted to do an archive of all the Middle European gestures of humankind with paper.
Right. Uh-huh.
So when we discovered this, we were like, we are trying to do the same, but this is, of course, it's impossible. How are you going to do an archive of all possible,
right,
you know,
yeah,
a human gestures? But he was trying to do the same.
Huh. Drawn pictures or?
Yeah. So I think photographers, but I don't remember.
Oh, so.
Wedburg. And we were like, wow, this is fascinating. And then we found Agamben, because of course it's impossible to have this archive because it's infinite.
Right.
The amount of, you know,
sure,
possibilities.
Right.
But this archive is very alive in your body.
Yeah.
Our body maps. I like this idea of mapping. Our
right.
body maps every single gesture you're going through.
Hmm.
So your body has this archive. Your
right.
body is an archive.
And it's why
it's the museum.
If you play an instrument, you have the muscle memory of always being able to
yeah.
go back.
So I also think the piece and the sets of pieces is also about that, the nervous system.
Hmm.
And how to access to that information.
Right.
Because you have that archive.
Hmm.
But then we found Agamben. So Agamben, what Agamben says in
the
community,
yeah.
Maneries is one of the chapters of the book, is that to reach this universal, he reaches through the example, through examples. So in one example, like these gestures, I'm talking about my body, and I'm talking about all possible bodies in the history of humankind and all in the aliens, whatever,
right.
past, future, present, that have gone through this gesture, through an example.
Do you
so he's trying to...
Not animals, though.
Not animals.
After yesterday, I was thinking about
it. Yeah. So, well, what was good for the process is that we found this idea of examples.
Right.
So, Maneries is a set of examples, because for Agamben, when you give an example, this interview is an example of all possible interviews in history
right.
of the universe.
Yeah.
And at the same time, it's talking only and about this interview.
Hmm.
And at the same time, it's talking about all possible interviews.
Right.
Ever and forever.
Yeah. Huh. So it's both the language that is, I mean, I know it's a sort of semiotic theory in a certain way.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the term itself, and then it's the gestures as the content, and it's both functioning at the same time, right? Which is what the work partly is doing as well. I mean, that what you're drawing from Maneries, right?
I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you find, you've said in another interview that you don't really feel, say, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but part of the dance community of Argentina, Buenos Aires, that most of you, well, I shouldn't say that, but a lot of your people that you're closest to, maybe influenced by or have conversations with are visual artists and the visual art world.
Yeah, in Buenos Aires it just happened.
Yeah.
It just happened to be that way. For instance, I feel closer or more inside the Sao Paulo, Buenos Aires dance scene.
Uh-huh.
And I have a lot of friends there, and they have supported my work a lot with presenting opportunities and with money and with residences and inviting me to direct residences. Oh, so it just happened that the dialogue just grew a little bit more with Sao Paulo, for instance.
Right. So
while in Buenos Aires, like from the past, I don't know, maybe 3 or 4 years, I was more sort of accepted and talked about in the visual arts world because they also got to be my friends.
Right.
So I was just having more fun in this
right.
world.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
it's not, it's, yeah, it just...
Well, I was wondering if you felt that even, not that labels matter, but that dance as it's thought about is too confining a genre for the way your work, the questions you're asking, the issues you're dealing with, whether you see it, whether you relate to some of the lineages that exist in modern and postmodern dance.
Yeah, well, I clearly had some interest for philosophy and from just going around these ideas, conceptual ideas, not really knowing what I'm talking about because I never went to university or never studied. You know, like always being self-taught. But so I think, yes, in Brazil, the habit of talking about this conceptual ideas and into practice is a little bit more developed. So right. they sort of started to put into words better and faster what I was doing. And I didn't know how to speak about it. And they were writing articles and things about these pieces. And I was like, oh, this is so amazing. Yes, I agree. I read that book. I didn't know how to say it.
Right.
And they were putting it into words. So I was like, oh, this is so comforting. Well, maybe in Buenos Aires, I felt that I wasn't part of this so much kind of theater dance scene.
Yeah.
So I wasn't coming from theater.
Yeah.
And, you know,
you must find compatriots in France, in other parts of Europe, in New York City, elsewhere, even here in Minneapolis, that are thinking along similar lines, but are working in dance.
Or? I don't know what you think, but I felt lately that to work with such a strong amount of movement in these pieces, for instance, because in later pieces there is no movement, and not working with text, because in my pieces there is no usually like reaching out to the audience text.
As
is so much nowadays.
Yes, right.
It's sort of strange. I don't know what you think. That lately, although the works deal with all these ideas that are very current, it seems to me that everyone is just talking to the audience, and and I'm not like that. I'm like, oh, fuck. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Is this okay? Is this still going to be okay? Because they just move and they are trying to deal with these concepts, you know, silently.
Right. Yeah.
And I love and I like that mutism that's inherent to dance.
Yeah.
And Agamben talks a lot about that mutism, how strong that is, how violent it is. And I liked it. And it's got a lot to do with this body as linguistic material that is talking about language, but it's not speaking.
Right.
So lately I've been thinking about that.
Because you're finding that a lot of contemporary dance makers are referring back to language, utilizing language.
Yeah, and just very, you know, breaking this fourth wall.
Right,
and
right.
I'm trying to, I mean, I, you know, it's just not movement. It's a lot of ideas around thinking the body and possible bodies and trying to link science and theory and philosophy and practice and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But I don't speak to the audience.
Yeah. I think that's okay. It's still a much debated question.
So I'm thinking about that. Just, you know, I have to do what I can do.
Yeah.
But I feel inside like very a lot of, you know, world that is, you know, mixing philosophy and science and art and practice. But then I'm feeling a bit outside.
Well, I wondered, I was almost going to ask the opposite, was whether you felt the field of dance, even the very contemporary dance world, could use a stronger dose of philosophy and science and theory, and that that is part of your mission to bring dance, to bring a sort of certain kind of cerebral rigor to a form that maybe sometimes draws from other influences than
I don't, I don't think I have a mission in that sense.
Right.
I mean, it would be like too much of a task.
Right.
Yeah, just, you know, just, then I just think, okay, you know, I have to like trust, you know, whatever I'm doing and just do, you know, capitalistic. Just do the best I can and then we'll see. You know, there are so many things going on in the market and in the trends and things.
When you say the market, you mean like the market. We sometimes pretend in the performing art worlds that there isn't as much of a market as there is in the visual art world.
Oh, yeah, there is.
But there's a total,
there is.
I mean, like, who's getting booked or presented or commissioned and things
Argentina,
like that?
Argentina, theater.
Right.
No, Brazil, body. So there are so many just like catalogs, and although presenters try to escape, you know, and look at the artists and what artists are doing, you know, if you have two theater pieces in a festival from Buenos Aires, maybe the third one is going to be a dance piece from Brazil.
Yes,
it
right.
happens.
Right. I brought up the question of dance as a form. I mean, we you know, curatorially think about a sort of kind of timeline of the development of dance, at least in North America, where modern dance evolved into people like Cunningham and others, and then postmodernism, and kind of whether you saw elements of some of those movements and movements that extended outside of just dance, say minimalism and your use of repetition, whether you were seeing yourself as part of that history and you placed yourself as part of that trajectory or really outside of it.
Yeah, I haven't thought about that.
Like when you studied dance, were there teachers or movements, techniques that you were particularly drawn to or that influenced?
I don't want them to sound like model figures,
right,
because
right.
I never had.
Yeah.
But I was very triggered, for instance, when I saw one of the earliest Ennio Greco pieces.
Oh yeah, sure.
And it was so fast, and it was so, and I was just triggered because I was so, it was so empathic. I liked
right.
that
yeah.
tool.
Yeah.
Like we were so inside the piece, and it was
yes.
very minimalistic and
right.
repetitive.
Extra
and I
drive.
Was like, there was something I was, or some of like foresight pieces.
Right.
But then they are not my references.
Uh-huh.
No, because
right.
I think, for instance, in Maneries and other pieces around it, I have also worked with some club references and some, nightlife references and this embodily imagination process that also happens in a disco, for instance,
right.
you know, in a community space when people gather and
yeah.
just, you know, evoke certain things that are also about repetition and listening and
right.
and putting your body into motion and
yeah.
community.
Right.
So I don't think they have any of these, maybe in some pieces, I don't know,
yeah.
of these references.
Yeah, yeah. Are there other
but
things?
I haven't placed myself in history, I don't know.
Yeah.
Maybe I should think more about that.
I wonder if writers, write about that, like, you know, where you'll...
Well, there was a very nice review in Brazil once that thought that Maneries and Ouroboros, which is another piece right after Maneries,
yeah.
were working on some kind of perception. And she said, the author, that I was doing some kind of actualization, like, is that a word?
Yeah.
of the 3D that Oscar Schmeller from Bauhaus was doing with this with his geometrical figures.
Right.
So she thought I was reenacting this, but without costumes, just with the body, and working with this very geometrical figures, but going farther in the way, trying to sort of punch the audience's perception. And she sort of thought we are living in a moment and a state in which our perception is sort of controlled and, you know, sort of going like...
The digital age with all the screens.
Yeah.
That
and so she thought I was going for that, like going an actualization of pre-D Oscar Schmeller geometrical figures,
right.
but without costumes, and going to like sort of trying to make a scratch on perception. I don't know, I really like
yeah.
that comment. That
yeah.
was so like, that would be so nice.
Huh.
Because I work with, as we started talking, with perception and how the audience is perceiving what they're seeing on stage through their eyes, but then trying to like scratch it, you know?
You're trying to
scratch
it.
Like, I hypnotize you and you're looking at that, but then, you know, we are talking about that.
Right.
We're talking about perception and how, you know, trying to make a scratch on that.
Yeah. So it displaces people's expectations
so.
A little bit. And yeah.
and it's sort of, I think it's political and it also talks about the theater and the architectural
frame
of theater, and this frontal thing that then I broke in other pieces, letting people free. But
sure.
I like talking about this sort of cave that the theater is, and it's so engaging and it's hypnotizing, I don't know how you say it. But if we make a scratch on that, then we are talking about that. Yes, you are there just watching, and that is very, so amazing, and it's very stupid. It's so like, you know.
So you're like, you're not interested, I mean, clearly, in just creating the hypnotic illusion, it's also critiquing or poking a hole in it while it's also completely capturing you up as an audience member.
Yeah. I like that moment of sort of hyper reality.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, this has been great, too. Thanks for, I feel like we could talk for a few more hours, but I was going to finish by that you're here at an unusual moment. It's completely off subject,
yes.
But when you just referenced popular dance and being, sometimes having an influence from dance hall and having the death of Prince yesterday while you're here, I wondered if you had any reflections on that.
It feels very strange. Like, we had the premiere yesterday, and we are in Minneapolis. I don't know, it's just weird. It's a coincidence.
Yeah.
And I love coincidences. Mm. I love them. Like, mm. one of the things that why I started believing in astrology is because, like, 8 years ago, I had a big coincidence in my life. Like, it was like, then I was in an astrologist, and he was like, okay, this month, this time, something, a cycle is changing. And I was like, well, at this moment, at that time, this happened. And then he was saying, okay, but then that cycle of this planet, whatever, is going to really start happening in this month and this time. And I was like, okay, but this situation, this person, I met again at this month and this time. So I was like, I love coincidences.
Huh.
So it was very strange yesterday. I don't know, it's been beautiful because I had these completely different images of Minneapolis. Like, I saw the pictures of the walker on internet, and I thought it would be like some kind of Tokyo city, like modern, and because the building is so, you know,
contemporary
architecture.
Yeah.
And then Minneapolis is just so different, and it's so much like imperfect and underground, and so much more interesting than that.
Huh.
Like the music scene
and
Prince and all the experimental dancing that we've talked and the artists that we met. And it's been just like, wow, like, this is so interesting. And like the harsh conditions of the city in terms of the cold and the snow. And then just thinking that Prince, you know, he could have just bought a mansion in New York or LA or London, whatever. But no, he decided to live here, you know, 10 kilometers from the city center.
Right.
So it's been just weird. And and every time you get in a car now, you get to listen to Prince. And it's just been like, I don't know.
And last night we had this sort of multiple soundtrack of every car surrounding us, stuck on Hennepin Avenue, everyone playing Prince at the same time. And it was also a mournful moment in the city, too, a sense of loss, because people felt so much he was our artist in some ways. But.
Yeah, and it's just, I mean, it's just like amazing. Yeah. I mean, it's a cliche to talk about what he did, but I've been thinking a lot, I mean, he was very ritualistic, and he was very strange with this changing names and putting the symbols, very enigmatic. What I like the most about Prince is, because I'm not good at interviews, although we have talked a lot, I'm very like, oh, I don't want to do this. I don't want to talk about
it. Thank
you for doing it. No. I mean, because I feel like comfortable, but it's hard to speak. I don't know. I talk about Prince. So he would go on stage and receive these prizes, and he will be so mean.
Right.
And so, like, such a character, like, just bringing his friends on stage and just saying nothing, just thank you, and so dry.
Right.
And I loved that. He was so strange, and I would be like, I wish I could do that. You know? Very diva.
But it also, I think, related to his his very shyness as well. It was a way of doing, like, deal
very,
with the world.
Like, fighting in a very simple and strange way the establishment. With his attitude, his dryness, his awkwardness, and then being sort of conservative at the same time because with this witness of
Jehovah's Witness.
But then his looks and his androgynous and his drag and his queer embodied theory. I know it was pretty impressive.
Yeah,
it's strange, nice to be here.
Well, I look forward to tonight getting a chance to see Maneries again, and it's such a pleasure to have you and Florencia and Mauro, everybody here. So
thank you.
Thanks so much, Luis.